to our live stream service this morning with Baltimore Avenue Church of God. We want you to take a few minutes or a few seconds to share this and comment, tag someone as we begin our service this morning. We do want to make note that due to the someone being exposed to coronavirus is the reason we are doing our live stream service this morning. It is not someone in our church, but someone in the community. And due to that fact, we want to pray for our churches that are involved, and we want to take safety precautions and abide by what we need to do to keep everybody safe this morning. So we will be having our live stream service this morning as we begin. It is Pentecost Sunday, and I'm excited for what God's going to do this morning. Wherever you're at, if you're in your house or watching from your couch, wherever you may be, we just pray that God would move in your life this morning as we begin. I want to share a scripture, and we're going to go to the Lord in prayer. And then we have a few songs before Pastor Upchurch comes and brings the word this morning. I want to read in John 14, verse 6, and most everybody is familiar with this verse. And Jesus said to him, he said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." And I think about that verse, and it says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." He didn't say, "I am a way," or "a truth," or "a life." Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." So I want to encourage you this morning, if you're on the mountaintop, he's the way. If you're in the valley, he's the way. If you're dealing with this COVID-19 pandemic that we're in, I want to tell you this morning that he is the way. He is the life. He is the truth. During all these rites, guess what? He is the way. He's the only way that we can have salvation, we can have peace, we can have joy, we can have freedom in our life. He is the only way this morning. So I encourage you this morning, if you're going through something, no matter if you're joyful or if you're sad or if you're going through something in your life, I want to encourage you this morning that he is the way. He is the one we lean to. He is our rock. He's our fortress, as it says in Psalms. And I just praise him this morning during Pentecost Sunday that he is the way, the truth, and the life. I just want to encourage you. You don't have to be in this building, in this church house. Yes, it's amazing when the people of God surround each other and are together. And just like in the upper room, they were together. But you don't have to have a Pentecost experience with other people around you. You can have it right there with God. The Holy Spirit can come in. It said that our bodies are the temple of the Holy Ghost. And if we invite him into our temple this morning, his oil will flow into our vessels. And I just praise him for that this morning. So I just ask you to stand wherever you're at, wherever you may be, and just worship just like you're in the house of God this morning. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you, Lord, for your son, Jesus. I thank you that you sent him to die on the cross for our sins, Father. Lord, and I thank you that he is the only way and the only life and the only truth that we know. And Lord, you said no one comes to the Father except by him. And I pray right now that if somebody watching this service this morning as we begin doesn't know you, Father, they don't know that Pentecost experience that they can have through the power of the Holy Ghost, that dunamis power, Lord, that you talk about in the Word of God. Lord, I pray right now, Lord, that they would experience that this morning as we begin our service. God, I pray that they would give their heart to you. And I just thank you and praise you for what you're going to do in this house this morning. Lord, for what you're going to do in families this morning, wherever they're watching. I just thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. And everybody out there said, amen. God bless you this morning.
Oh, helps me sing this next song. I just wanted to read a scripture in Numbers chapter 6, verse 24 through 26. It says, "The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace." And you know, this is a crazy time in our nation right now with coronavirus and now all the riots that have started. But our prayer for you today is that the Lord bless you and keep you, regardless of what is happening in this nation, regardless of what is happening around us today. Just make that your prayer today and sing this with us.
In your joy, you're my peace. You're my comfort in time of need. You're my refuge, you're my rock, you're the one I depend on. You're the road to hope when the light grows dim, when the waves of doubt come crashing in. You're my anchor in the troubled storm, Almighty God. You're my joy, you're my peace. You're my comfort in time of need. You're my refuge, you're my rock, you're the one I depend on. You're the road to hope when the light grows dim, when the waves of doubt come crashing in. You're my anchor in the troubled storm, Almighty God. That I might see the kind of man that I should be. You came to die to set me free, Almighty God. You bore the cross and you bear the scars. You are my bright, my shining star. That I might see the kind of man that I should be. You came to die to set me free, Almighty God. You're my joy, you're my peace. You're my comfort in time of need. You're my refuge, you're my rock, you're the one I depend on. When the light grows dim, when the waves of doubt come crashing in, you're my anchor in the troubled storm, Almighty God. You're my joy, you're my peace, you're my comfort in time of need. You're my refuge, you're my rock, you're the one I depend on.
Son today, a youth pastor and his wife, Brother Decker, and my daughter Tara, and all those who are helping us in the media. Today's Pentecost Sunday. We want to talk a little bit today about the Holy Spirit in the church, his work. And we're going to be reading today in John and also in Acts, the second chapter. I know that's a big subject when you talk about the Holy Spirit. We'll just be able to scratch the surface a little bit today. It's an important subject, and because the Holy Spirit is involved in all of our relationships with God. We will find that the the Holy Spirit is involved in all 100% the working, because He is God. You can't be saved and have a relationship with God apart and separate from the Holy Spirit. You may not have been baptized fully of the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in other tongues, but if you have a relationship at all with God, it's because and through the Holy Spirit. Paul said in Corinthians, "For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have been all made to drink into one Spirit." So there's one Holy Spirit, thank God, who's part of the Godhead. Hallelujah. John said in 1 John, he said, "For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one." So if you want to read with us today in John and also in Acts, in Acts, the first chapter, Jesus, you know, had been resurrected, and he was here on earth about 40 days, I believe it was, before he ascended back to heaven. And during that time, there's a lot of people saw the Lord, and he appeared to the apostles, and the Bible said that he just appeared. The doors were shut, and the Bible was very careful in both places to say the doors were shut. And then came Jesus. And so it seems that he just appeared there with the apostles, the 10, and then later with the 11, when doubting Thomas had been added to the group. The Bible said 8 days later. But if you'll notice what Jesus said, he said, "Peace be unto you." And then he said, he breathed on them and said, "Receive ye the Holy Ghost." Praise God. So we're celebrating that today, Pentecost Sunday, and I'll tell a little more here about what it means in a little bit. But in Acts, the first chapter, "And being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, ye have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence." Excuse me. And then in verse 8, he said, "But you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, and in all Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth." And then in John, the 15th chapter, Jesus speaking, he said, "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it's expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you. And when he has come, he will reprove the world of sin, and of righteousness, and of judgment. Of sin, because they believe not on me. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father, and ye shall see me no more. Of judgment, because the prince of the world is judged. I have many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. Happy it when he, the Spirit of truth, is come. He will guide you into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine and shall show it unto you. All things that the Father hath are mine. Therefore said I that he shall take of mine and shall show it unto you." Oh, hallelujah be unto his wonderful name. So what does it mean when we say that we are Pentecostal? There's a lot of people believe in the Holy Spirit, but they're not Pentecostal. But when we say that we're Pentecostal, it is saying basically that we believe in the baptism of the Holy Spirit as a separate experience from salvation. Then also it means that we believe in the gifts that are listed, excuse me, in 1 Corinthians 12, the gifts of the Spirit, the word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, faith and miracles and gifts of healing and discerning of spirits and diverse kinds of tongues and interpretation of tongues. And then thirdly, it means that we believe and we have received the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the power of the Holy Spirit, as Jesus talked about. You shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Praise God. And these are gifts that God has put in the church for those who are filled with the Holy Spirit. They are operated by the Holy Spirit as we yield ourselves unto Him. We have no authority or ability to speak in tongues on our own volition, except the Spirit gives the utterance. Now look at the work of the Holy Spirit in conversion. You know, the Holy Ghost was dealing with you, if you're saved today, a long time, probably before you prayed the sinner's prayer. He's the one that brings the love of God to us and the mercy of God to us. He's the one that draws us. He's the one that makes us feel that we need to be saved. So He's working even though people don't realize it. Praise God. In verse 8, He said, when He has come, He will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. He's the one that has been called the conscience of men. The Holy Spirit moves across this world. There are no boundaries or no limits to His movement, but He moves across continents and state lines. He moves behind the so-called Iron Curtain of communism that we talked about for so many years. He's the Spirit of truth. A person, maybe not even a Christian, many times, they will feel guilty if they tell a lie or if they commit a crime or a sin or hurt somebody. And He's been called the conscience of men. And He lets even people that do not know God feel guilty, feel bad when they do something that is wrong. Now, that conscience can be overridden and that conscience can become hardened. How could a person do some terrible crimes that we see in the world today, where they maybe kill several people? How can they be so hardened? It's because the heart has become hardened and they've overridden the Holy Spirit many, many times. They don't weep anymore because their heart is so hard. Can I tell you that it's a wonderful thing to have a soft and tender heart where you can cry? People sometimes apologize for crying. Don't do that. Crying is a sign of a tender heart before God, one that can be touched by the Spirit of God. I heard it said as I was growing up, big boys don't cry. But I say that's not right. Tears are a language that God understands. In fact, Jesus Himself cried. Praise God. The Bible said that Jesus wept at the tomb of Lazarus. And Solomon said there's a time to weep and a time to laugh. When your heart is breaking over a loss of some kind, when your son or daughter is bound by the devil's bonds, when there's trouble brewing and the devil is about to steal a soul, a tender heart before God is a wonderful thing. Praise God. When you're moved upon by the Holy Spirit, glory to God. I remember one of our leaders told about his daughter that was wayward and not living for God. Gone. They didn't know where she was at. And the hearts of this mom and dad were crying and weeping. And the mother would go to her bedroom and fall across the bed and weep before God. God was hearing that. The Holy Spirit was there intervening. Glory to God. He's been called the High Sheriff of Heaven. They may run, but they can't run far enough to get away from the Holy Spirit. They may try to hide and shut it out, but He can get into bed with them at night. Before they go to sleep, wake them up in the middle of the night. Take sleep away from them. Oh, hallelujah be to God. And deal with Him. After a period of time, this daughter called this mother and dad and said, "Can I come home?" Why? Because the Holy Spirit, glory to God, had dealt with her and brought her back to God. Jeremiah said, "My soul shall weep in secret places. Mine eyes shall weep sore, run down with tears, because the Lord's flock is carried away captive." Jeremiah was called and known as the weeping prophet because he wept before God for the destruction of his people. How about us today? What's happening in our nation? Are we going to cry before God and weep before God at the terrible things that are happening in our world today? I want to tell you, God is still God. He is still able to do exceeding abundantly above all we could ask or think, according to the power that works in us. He said, the psalmist said, "Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning." Thank God for when the Holy Spirit gives victory. Glory to God. Hallelujah. So he brings us to God. He's been calling. Glory to God. And then you come to Him. Oh, that's the work of the Holy Ghost. He lets you feel your need of God. Some of you listening today might be feeling that uneasy feeling. What's going to happen when I die? When I close my eyes in death, what's going to happen? I'm going to tell you what's going to happen. If you don't know God, then you're going to be separated. That enemy is going to take your hand and lead you to that place that you don't even want to think about. But thank God, if you're a Christian, then He's going to take your hand and lead you into the, oh, hallelujah, into heaven. Bless His wonderful name today. Glory to God. So the Holy Spirit deals with us. He said here in this text, "He shall glorify me, he shall receive of mine, and shall show it unto you." And when you repent, and when you confess your sins, and when you say, "Lord, I accept you," the Holy Spirit brings the love of God and the mercy of God. And He brings all that and puts it together. And He gives us that birth. You can't give yourself birth. Your mother had to give physical birth to you and to me. We don't give ourselves birth. But thank God the Holy Spirit then takes all of those that confessing and repenting and feeling sorry for your sin, and He applies the love of God and the mercy of God, and He gives you a birth. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. So Nicodemus came, and Jesus said, "Except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." And He said, "Except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot see the kingdom of God." So He makes us worthy, glory to God, by giving us a birth. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And then people say, I feel Jesus in my heart. Yes, you have that Holy Spirit of Jesus in your heart, but it's not the baptismal measure of the Spirit. You see, when He comes in, He gives us the earnest of the Spirit, and that's the first payment, or the down payment, that assures the deal that we belong to God. Because Jesus Himself is at the right hand of God the Father. God is on the throne. Jesus, His Son, is at His right side. And you say, "I feel it." Yes, you feel the Spirit of God in your heart. Glory to God. Paul said, "The Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs, and joint heirs with Jesus Christ." But then Pentecostals know and teach that the Holy Ghost is baptism is an entirely separate experience than salvation. We say that we're Pentecostals. Where did that word come from? Well, Pentecost is the Greek name meaning the 50th day. It was a Jewish festival that was commanded by God when they brought offerings to the Lord. It was also called the Feast of Harvest and the Feast of Weeks. It was called the Day of First Fruits. It was held 50 days after Passover when Christ was crucified. It was on the Feast of Pentecost when the initial or the first outpouring of the Holy Ghost took place. There were Jews there from all around the world in Jerusalem to celebrate this feast. You see, they didn't have radio and TV and newspapers and all the media to advertise this. But God had a plan. Aren't you glad that somebody's got a plan? You see, with all the confusion in the world today, men are reacting to what's happening. But I'm glad to say God's not reacting, thank God. He had a plan before the foundation of the world. He's working his plan. In all the confusion, all the problems of this world, God is still working his plan among his people. Glory to God. He's got a plan for you today. He's got a plan for the human race. He's got a plan for your family. He's got a plan for you personally today to give you peace and an expected end, as Jeremiah said, a future and a hope. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. And that plan is for the blood of Jesus to cover your sins and to wash your sins away and to give you eternal life. Glory to God. To give you peace in your heart that men cannot give. Praise God. Hallelujah. John said, rather, my little children, these things I write unto you that you sin not. But if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he's the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but for the sins of the whole world. Praise God. You know, God knew that we needed something more than just to be forgiven of our sins, but we needed the power of the Holy Spirit in us to help us to live this life, a power that was greater than anything we could ever face. Praise God. And God has the answer to our weakness, and that is the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the power of God. You know, Jesus said, you shall receive power. It's not just power to witness, and that it is power to witness, but thank God it's power to live right. It's power to live a holy life in an ungodly world. Praise God. So Jesus, God chose Jerusalem as the place to fulfill Joel's prophecy of the last days. He chose the Feast of Pentecost because there were people there from all over the world that had come for this feast. The Bible said there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men out of every nation. And they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, behold, are not all these which speak Galileans? And hear we every man in our own tongue wherein we were born. We could compare it to this. Somebody comes into our church and they say, well, these are all natives from Alabama that speak English with a southern drawl. And here we hear them speaking in another language. I was born in China. I hear somebody speaking in Chinese. Or I was born in Germany and I hear somebody speaking German. I was born in Italy and I hear somebody speaking Italian or Arabic or Korean. Now, devotional tongues are different. They may not be a distinct language. You know, God is a sovereign God. He can do what he wants to. We can't put God in a box. Glory to God. All tongues are not a language, but some are. I heard and read this story here where a foreigner heard someone speak distinctly in their language, and it spoke to them. It was in the evangel. And this man wrote this testimony. He said, "My mother never thought of herself as a preacher, but she once preached a sermon without knowing it. She was taken to the hospital for surgery, but something happened. All the time she was being operated on, she was speaking in tongues as the Holy Spirit moved upon her. A Hispanic doctor was assisting the surgery, and when she came to, he was gone. 2 weeks later, he came to see her and immediately asked her the question, 'Where did you learn to speak such beautiful Spanish?' He said, 'Mom,' replied, 'I don't know any Spanish.' The doctor was astounded. He said, 'All the time we were operating on you, you were speaking in the most beautiful Spanish, telling me about a man called Jesus. I thought you were crazy until toward the end of the surgery. You told me to go home because I was needed there. As soon as I finished the surgery, I was handed a note stating that my father had suffered a heart attack down in the islands. That's where I've been for the past 2 weeks. So God used this woman to speak to a Hispanic surgeon about the power of God. God knows who needs to be convinced. He knows who needs to have their eyes open. Praise God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So Jesus told those Jews, he said, 'Don't depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, and you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence.' Now, how did they get from the upper room unto out in the street or in the courtyard? They started off in the upper room praying and seeking God. And then after a few days, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, as I read to you, glory to God, in Acts 2, he said they were in one accord, one place, when the Holy Spirit was poured out. And how did they, all these Jews from around the world, get to see them? Well, they were in the upper room, then they got down into the courtyard, and they got out into the public arena. I imagine some of them might have been crying. Some of them might have been jumping or dancing because they were excited and feeling the presence of the Lord. We have witnessed all of that. And some of them mocking, said, "Well, these people are drunk with wine. They were acting like drunk people." Have you ever seen a drunk cry? I have. I remember one day when we were in Tennessee, there was a man came by and he was completely drunk. He was crying. He was confessing all kinds of sins of people and things he had been involved in. And I thought, oh, I don't need to hear all of this because it can be dangerous because of the things he had been doing. But he was crying and poured it all out. Have you ever seen a drunk dance or fall in the floor? Oh yeah, some of you did that yourself before you got saved. But now you're filled with the Spirit, glory to God. You're not filled with alcohol, but you're filled with the Spirit of God. Hallelujah, glory to God. You know, it was saved people that Jesus told to go to Jerusalem and tarry until they were endued with power from on high. Peter and John taught them about the Holy Ghost. And then they laid their hands on them at the Samaritan Pentecost in Acts 8:4. The people of Samaria were saved. And they sent Peter and John down there. And when they laid their hands on them, they received the Holy Ghost. And then in Acts 10, we have the Gentile Pentecost. Cornelius the Gentile was praying. And God sent the Apostle Peter to his home. and to preach to them. While Peter preached, the Holy Ghost fell on them, and they spake with other tongues. And then in Acts 19:2, Paul found certain disciples at Corinth, and he said unto them, "Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed?" Now that tells me that they were already saved. John had baptized them. And they said unto him, "We've not had so much as heard whether there be any Holy Ghost." He said unto them, "What were you baptized?" They said, "Unto John's baptism." And so John had preached to them about repenting, and they had repented, and they had been saved. And praise God, but oh, glory to God, God had more for them. Hallelujah. Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? Glory to God. The Apostle Peter, when the Holy Spirit was poured out, he said, "These are not drunk as you suppose," but he said, "This is that which is prophesied by Joel." In the second chapter of Joel, he said, "In the last days, saith God, I'll pour out of my spirit upon all flesh, on your sons and your daughters and the old people." Glory to God. You see, Jesus had to go back to heaven to sit at the right hand of God the Father to intercede for you and I. But he said, "If I go away, thank God, I'll send you another comforter." Glory to God. He left and he sent the Holy Ghost just like he said. And he's here today. And since that time, multiplied millions have received the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in other tongues. You know, when you count the charismatics and those who call themselves Pentecostal, there's somewhere around 600 million people around the world that have received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. He don't speak of himself or promote himself, but he points men to the Lord Jesus Christ. Glory be unto his wonderful name. Don't you love him today? Glory to God. I love him today. And I thank God for the Holy Ghost. Praise God. I want you to notice he said here in John that he is a comforter. What is a comforter? Well, when you look at that word, then it means that he's an advocate. He'll go right along beside of you. He's not one just to make you feel good. We do that. We get excited sometimes. Oh, glory to God. We shout, or we praise God, or we cry. We raise our hands because we feel the glory of the presence of God in our hearts. But he's more than that. Thank God he'll go right along beside of you. You know, some people may be working against you sometime, and things may be working against you in this world. But can I tell you, you've got one who's going along beside of you. He's the greatest lawyer you can ever have. He's the greatest helper you can ever have. He's an advocate. Thank God he's got your back. If you'll give yourself fully unto the Lord, thank God, he'll be the lifter up of your head. He'll promote you. Glory to God. He'll, oh, hallelujah. He'll take care of you. He'll supply your need. Oh, hallelujah be to God. You say, "Brother Church, I've got problems I can't solve." I will tell you, there's somebody who can solve those problems, and his name is Jesus. The Holy Ghost did not take him the place of Jesus. He's promoting Jesus and salvation. He's working with Jesus. Oh, thank God, there are three that bear record in heaven: the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. And these three are one. He's working the kingdom of God, and he'll put you in it. He'll set you up. Glory to God. He'll set you up straight. Help you walk the straight and the narrow path. Help you be ready to leave this old world. We're all going to leave one day. Glory to God. Hallelujah. He'll get you ready to go to the next world. Oh, hallelujah. And when this life is over, he'll take your hand. Hallelujah. He'll say, "My child, your chariot awaits." Glory to God. He'll help you over the river of death. He'll help you in all your problems. Glory to God. There are people in our church that used to have all kind of problems and hang-ups. Thank God, but one day they gave their heart to God, and God gave them grace and strength. Glory to God. He put them on the solid foundation. He washed their sins away. He helped them get control and victory over those destructive habits. That devil put all kind of habits upon you that will pull you down, destroy your body, destroy your heart, destroy your life and your family. But thank God, the Lord came to set the captive free, and He uses the Holy Spirit in our lives. Thank God, glory to God. He said, if you through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, you shall live. You may not be able to quit smoking and drinking and drugging, but through the power of the Lord, through the blood of Jesus, and through the grace and power of the Holy Spirit, thank God, you can be set free and have that destructive habit broken off of your life. Hallelujah. Oh, glory to God. Your trouble today with all that's happening in this world, He can give you peace. If you'll notice, when Jesus appeared to those 11 apostles, He said, peace be unto you. The first thing He said was peace. And then Isaiah said, thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee. If you're troubled today about what's happening in this world, let me give you a little bit of advice. First of all, turn that television off and quit listening to all this fear-mongering and all the trouble in the world. And secondly, get your Bible and get down and read about Jesus Christ and the promises of God, and let Him speak peace into your troubled soul. He can do it. Thank God. Hallelujah. His peace is not depending on what's happening in the world. Jesus said, peace I leave with you, and my peace I give unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, and neither let it be afraid. So thank God, if you want peace today, it starts with the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the Prince of Peace. He'll give you peace in your heart. He'll give you joy in your heart. He'll give you hope, thank God. The world without Christ looks awful dark with a cloud hanging over us because of the virus and because of all these other problems. But I will tell you, there's one who is a God of hope, and His name is Jesus. Thank God, hallelujah, and the Holy Spirit. Don't be afraid of the Holy Spirit moving on you. He's a perfect gentleman, but thank God, He'll work a work in your life that'll give you eternal life, eternal joy, and peace and victory. Praise God. Hallelujah. Be unto His name. We're going to pray here today and believe God is going to help you. Praise God. Believe God is going to move in your heart. Believe God is going to give you peace. Believe God is going to even baptize you with the Holy Spirit. If you're hungry for more of God, hallelujah, you might be saved today. You said, brother of church, I want more of God. I want joy unspeakable and full of glory. There's joy at being saved, but there's greater joy at being filled with the Holy Spirit. Glory to God. But the first thing is to get sin out of the way. And if you have sin in your heart today, we're going to pray. You pray this prayer with me. You pray it from the bottom of your heart and ask God to forgive you of all your sins. Jesus died, His blood was shed, that you could be forgiven. But it can only be forgiven if you confess it. He said, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So today we'll pray, first of all, for you to be forgiven. And then if you want to be filled with the Spirit, you say, Lord, I want the Spirit of truth. I want the Comforter. I want the one that can give me glory, God, power to live this Christian life. Let's pray together. And you pray this prayer with me. Oh Lord, I thank you today for your love and for your mercy. I thank you for the cross. I thank you for Jesus and His blood. I thank you for His death. And Lord, the resurrection that gives us hope be on this life. I confess my sins today. Please forgive me of all my sins. Come into my heart. Make me a new creation. Write my name down in the Lamb's Book of Life. I accept Jesus as my Lord and Savior today. And please fill me with your Holy Spirit. I'm hungry, Lord. He said, blessed are they that hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. God bless you today. We will be having service tonight at 5 p.m. Be streaming. And also on Wednesday night at 6:30. So God bless you as our prayer. Call us 256-878-2037 for prayer. And we'll be praying for you. God bless you as our sister plays today.
Is what our heart.